Welcome to Neelima, who is giving a talk this afternoon. Thank you all for coming. It's in the middle of this four deadlines week, which is what I was trying to tell her. Neelima is a journalist and a researcher, and with a very strong interest in the issues facing farmers of the country. She's written fiction as well as non-fictional accounts of her engagement with this very grave and important matter. Her recent book is Widows of Vidarbha, which is a series of interviews she has done over time with the widows of farmers of community suicide. Her talk today is titled Vantages of Reality, where she's trying to explain her struggle to bring alive problems in ways outside of conventional genre expectations. Neelima.
First of all, thank you for being here, and apparently a very tough day with a lot of meetings and stuff. Thank you very much. I'm very glad to be here. Thanks to Professor Chandan Gowda for calling me. Thank you. I write about fundamentally two issues, farmers and gender, and that's what I would like to talk about in terms of the vantages of reality. What I mean by that is that we assume there's a reality out there. First, we have to assume that there is a reality out there and that we are trying to access it. Then in that case, how do we access it in different ways? I mean, my fundamental central argument, which I discuss in my book also, is that the method somehow chooses the reality which we finally access. And that's something which we all know when we do research. So my submission today would be that a particular methodology might lead to a particular truth. So it only provides a partial and incomplete view of the reality. So I also faced it in my own research, and I tried to negotiate this through different ways of accessing reality, and I had a few tools or methodologies with me. One was journalism. That's something in which I was trained. Second is academics, again, another thing which I was trained in. And the third is fiction. Third one is obviously quite different from the first two, and that's why probably it's interesting, and you know, maybe you will, when we discuss, maybe we can explore more. And I'll just briefly talk about what I have found over a period of time and then get down to actually demonstrating what I mean. But what my experience has been that the reality out there or what we believe we are studying, that the subject on the field has to be constructed through different vantages. And it really, truly defies any particular methodology. That's been my finding. So I'll now begin with the first step in my life, which was the most exciting, which was to get to be a journalist and therefore, you know, sort of be the rebel from everything which everybody taught and, you know, go and discover my own truth. And I'll give a recent example. I won't go back into my ancient history, but give a recent example. October 2nd, 2018, just 7 days ago, thousands of farmers had reached the outskirts of Delhi. You must have heard. They had marched from Haridwar. I'm just giving a brief outline of the example I'm trying to demarcate to just say that how the reality can be so different from what is being written these days, what is being perceived, and what is being discussed, and finally, what is being decided that this is the reality. So these farmers had, thousands of them, had marched from Haridwar to Delhi to pay respects to Mahatma Gandhi on his Jayanti at his Samadhi Rajghat, which is unfortunately imprisoned within Delhi. I mean, you have to enter Delhi to do that, but there you are. So, but these people were arrested. This happened on the morning of October 2nd, very early. And it happened, they were stopped on the outskirts. And it's not an easy thing to stop people from entering Delhi because it has a very porous border. But there was information about that fact that they were coming, and barricades were set up, hundreds of cops were deployed, and they were stopped. Fine, there was a threat perception, I don't know what, we were obviously never privy to what happened or why there was such a barricading of Delhi. But it was very clear in terms of perception, it was very clear that the government had feared that the farmers will take over Delhi. And that's what the social media post said, that they would not leave Delhi unless their demands were met. That was one of the fears, that they will come and occupy Delhi. And what were the demands? Better prices for their produce. The BJP, before 2014 elections, had promised the farmers that the farmers' demand for a better MSP would be met. They basically said that a revised calculation of the MSP would be done. The farmers were just coming into Delhi to just ask that you promised us this, why don't you give us these, the better MSP? There's a complicated equation behind it. I could get to it when we have a discussion. The farmers also wanted that the families of farmer suicides, the farmers who had committed suicide due to agricultural distress, should be rehabilitated and with state support and perhaps given a government job. Again, one of their fundamental demands. And they also wanted pension for farmers. After spending an entire lifetime working on agricultural fields, which do not get them out of even their own poverty, there's no change in their life. They're saying that, okay, we have done our bit, we would like the pension. And finally, they also wanted reduction of GST. GST is affecting some of the most wealthy people in this country, so naturally it is affecting those people who are the poorest, and their agricultural inputs. There is a 12% GST on agricultural inputs, and that's what they wanted. They wanted this. So these were the dangerous demands of the farmers, because of which they were not allowed into Delhi. And they obviously were wanting something which they had never got, which was the attention of the government, but not going to get it this time also. They were not going to be allowed inside. But I would like to now read from an article which I had written, and I also tell you why I had to write that, because the television channels, and this is where my argument about reality comes in, that you are going to be able to access reality only if you know that there is such a thing which has happened, right? And how do we do this? Events have to be mediatized, and mediatization itself has become so subjective that it's not necessary that we know what's happening out there. To give you an example, this is, to further this example, that morning we had a very few minutes of footage of the farmers trying to come into Delhi and being stopped, being lathi charged, being tear gassed. We had visuals of farmers lying on the roads, wounded. There was no medical sort of assistance. This could all be seen like in about maybe 10 to 20 minutes. But suddenly, the Prime Minister's speech on Mahatma began. He was talking about the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, his tribute to Gandhiji, and he also obviously was praising his own government for doing a wonderful job on the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. What happened? The farmers' protest was blacked out. Not a word after that, not an image of the protest came for as long as the Prime Minister spoke, and while the Prime Minister spoke, he did not speak about the protest. So if I were a viewer who was watching TV that day, after the Prime Minister started speaking, I would never know what was happening to the farmers right outside Delhi, just about half an hour away from where the Prime Minister was speaking. That's what I mean by reality, that reality has become so selective, it's impossible to actually grasp it, because the tools which are supposed to convey reality have failed, or rather are failing. So I'll briefly read what I wanted to bring this sort of a black spot or the darkened out kind of news back into some kind of a headline. So luckily we have social media. So what I had done was to write this, which I would like to read only some parts of it. The government in Delhi is apprehensive that if allowed, the farmers will walk on the well-paved roads of Delhi. And this is taken from the social media posts. The elderly among them might even decide to rest under the trees and mess up the aesthetics of the capital. They might bring the dirt of their agricultural fields to the fashionable spots of Delhi, and who knows, some of them might even end up in Khan Market. So such crises must be checked with efficiency. On the other hand, the farmer's life is dependent on whether Delhi accepts their demands. They want better prices for their produce, which is where I explained what the demands were. The only, I'm just saying that this was a way of writing. This was not very well-researched piece. I don't think that it is at all an academic piece. It was not even a well-researched journalistic piece because I was writing in a great deal of hurry. But I wanted that gap in the reportage to be covered. And that's exactly what journalism is doing these days. I think journalism is creating more gaps in conveying reality than covering them. At one point, journalists used to be doing exactly the reverse of it. Journalists used to be going beyond the reported, the known, and cover areas which were unreported. Now they are trying to unreport what should be reported. That was basically one example of what I had recently written and why I had written it. So in such a situation, what is the truth out there which has to be known? More importantly, that's what I'm saying, that if the viewer doesn't even get the choice, the selection of that truth, I mean, he or she does not even know that there is this protest which had happened, that people had got hurt, that farmers absolutely asking for very valid demands were denied entry into Delhi without any explanation, and no minister, nobody had met them till that point. How would the viewer choose any reality? I mean, how does this even work? That's what I meant, that mediatization of an event is subject to so many factors beyond the search and access of truth that it can no longer be counted on. But still, journalism is the most popular method of finding that reality, but that reality is neither objective nor comprehensive, and that's my submission today. So while I was a journalist, of course, this is not the first time I'm discovering, while I was a journalist, I discovered this several times, that you could not report what you knew for various reasons. And so one of my resolutions was to write those stories which you could not report as fiction. Now that's a very, very difficult step to take. It's actually a leap of faith, because for somebody who's trained to deal with facts, and you know, you have an argument, you build an argument and find conclusions, how do you write fiction? I mean, it's, and also not just any short piece. It's like fiction is about 70,000 to 1 lakh words of a story which has to be extremely plausible. It has to appear possible that it might happen this way. So, but one of the greatest things about fiction, at least the kinds which can tell the truth or the reality or negotiate with reality, is that there are investigations which can be communicated without the danger or the threat of pressures which are usually employed on investigative journalists, which despite that, we do see a lot of investigative journalism in this country. There's a huge amount of diligence on the part of activists as well as journalists when these investigative reports come out. They come out very simply, they come out very easily. It looks like just 4 columns of a story, but it's like months of work. But for every investigative story which comes out in Indian media, there are several which do not. And that's exactly what I wanted to write about. I'd like to give an example from my fiction book, because that will just demonstrate what I'm trying to say. It was published in 2016. That was about 18 months after the 2014 elections. And if you all recall, there was a great deal of surprise and disappointment that a slightly right-leaning government was elected at the center after elections, and a questioning of how this could happen in a secular and a pluralistic country like ours. As a researcher into electoral politics and with training into understanding electoral reforms, I could find several academic answers to this question. Once again, I found the truth was not so simple. And we all know that it's not just about voter behavior, who voted which way. But the truth was out there in plain sight, and the only challenge was how it could be recorded and presented. I decided to write it as a fictional narrative, which has always been more difficult. That's what I'm trying to say, that it is not so easy. You have to unlearn so much and learn so many things when you actually try to write something as a story. But that's sometimes the only way left to tell the truth or actually negotiate the reality. So this is from my book. It's called The Honest Season. This book actually talks about six conversations which had actually taken place, but the parliament I refer to here, for obvious reasons, it has to be a mythical parliament, not the real parliament, because it is fiction. And the characters here are all fictional. But I shall read now, and maybe you can recognize some of these characters and some of these controversies. So this is a conversation happening between a member of parliament. Of course, no resemblance with any member of parliament. Absolutely is coincidental. His name is Sikandar. So he's talking to a person often found in Delhi, of a variety, who could be loosely called a liaison person. And he or she, I mean, in this case it's a she, but he or she is usually very well connected. I or any one of us cannot walk into the kinds of places such a person can walk into, including the parliament. We would have to wait for a few days before we will be given passes into, you know, powerful places, but not such people. So this is a conversation between a member of parliament and such a liaison person, which happens very often in the corridors of this mythical parliament. It's got no resemblance with our parliament at all. So this is going to be a conversational thing. The difference between what I had written and what I had read out before, which was a journalistic piece, and what I'm going to read now, just by the structure of it, you will see how different it is. And please appreciate the effort it must have taken to write something like this. Anyway, so it begins. The lady's name is Kim, and this MP's name is Sikandar. He says, "Good morning, Kim. What a surprise." "Hi, Sikandar," she responded warmly. "How are you?" "Well, it's been an age since I saw you. Let's catch up while you wait." Then they catch up or they talk in this corridor. Kim says, "You are looking good, Sikandar, good and successful," because he just won an election. And he's the son of a very powerful politician. Again, something which has no resemblance to any other son of any other politician. Sikandar laughed. "It's just a matter of time. I'll be normal again. You look a little anxious, though." "Yes, I am," she said. "It's just that something important is not working out, you know. Might as well tell you. You see, your party needs a fall guy for the agriculture ministry, and I thought I might be able to help. Let me just explain a little." She is obviously trying. Again, you know, I don't want to mention any particular controversy. I'm sure you can recall. But this is about a conversation, very similar conversation, which was reported in the media. "Why, what is happening in the agriculture ministry?" he asked. "Something will happen there soon. As you know, I liaison for business houses, especially in political circles. So before the elections, I mediated a deal with the party in power for 3 cabinet portfolios in which certain business clients were interested. Now, after the elections, I'm being told by your party that only 2 of the 3 are available. 3 cabinet portfolios." Sikandar sounded surprised. It's unusual for the party to go back on a promise. She says, "It's more than unusual, it's bloody unfair." Kim was angry. "I spend money on lunches, dinners, airplane tickets, gifts, things I can't even mention as expenses. I won't get paid unless the deal is done." "That's sad," Sikandar said sympathetically, "especially when other business houses get the minister of their choice. Look at civil aviation." Kim says, "No, that's different. I mean, which other party would have got civil aviation? That party brings with itself a contract to buy 200 new aircrafts from a foreign country, government to government, with a hefty commission for the leadership. Such deals cannot be ignored. It takes money to contest elections, and you win elections to make more money. Sikandar asked, so why agriculture? Well, your party didn't want to offend the business houses, and so one of the politicians was asked to negotiate with us to accept agriculture as the third ministry, because there were three portfolios to be given, right? A good agriculture minister, also in charge of food and supplies, can control speculation on food production, stocks, imports, and exports by merely calibrating his public statements. He can hike up or drop prices of commodities. Now, once again, we have had agricultural ministers in this country who have randomly made statements which... Yeah, sorry. Louder? Oh, okay, sorry. I'm simply saying that this is no resemblance to any of our agriculture ministers who might have manipulated prices like this. Yes, but agriculture is not like ministries of power, defense, or even communication, where business houses bid to get a friendly minister, Kim argued. My instructions were, if we cannot get portfolio advantage from your party, we must be given policy advantage. The government plans to introduce foreign genetically modified seeds for all crops in the country in the coming years. This is being hailed as the new revolution in agriculture that will double the yield and enrich the farmers. Bottom line, the foreign seed companies and its local collaborations will enjoy dividends for decades. In other words, it's a golden egg. I see. So why isn't there a stampede for the golden egg? Because it's an illegal golden egg. Just picture this. Millions of farmers, thousands of seed varieties, hundreds of crops, one international supplier who has already been chosen by the government. This will be the largest government contract ever, and the agriculture minister will be in charge of it. Losers of bids will complain, expose faults, and demand investigation. The minister will be the fall guy, someone who does the job, makes the money, and in return takes the blame in court cases, audit inquiries, parliament committee hearings. When he finally steps aside, our new minister from the government will continue with business as before. Sikandar said, that sounds logical. What do you mean by fall guy? Indictment? Imprisonment? Kim says, both. But the government guarantees acquittal of the minister 1 year before the next parliament elections so that he can contest again. I don't want to really read more, but that's generally the gist of what I'm trying to say, that there was no way that any of this perception, any of this information, any of these pieces of information rather, could be put together as a journalistic story. It was well known. It was, in many cases, recorded. But as I said, this is about the fiction gives you this imaginary license to fill in the blanks and go into the subtext. So that's how I was able to tell, through 6 stories, which are in this book, what had to be told. Although, you know, everybody said that who's going to read this? I mean, who really cares? Everybody voted for a different party. So. But my argument was, how was India lost? We had to have an idea about what really happened. And it's not just electoral behavior analysis or researchers getting into talking about percentage points, but really get into the narrative of it. So I could present the various facets of the truth in a leisurely analysis. That was another thing about writing fiction. Although it is a difficult job, but what it does give you is the space to do a leisurely, relaxed analysis of what happened. It's a freedom that liberated my mind, truly, and because I could analyze the consequences without the structural restrictions of an academic article or a book. Also, I discovered that when this book became a bestseller, I discovered there was another angle to fiction. That it is not, it's usually seen as ineffective, easily read, a cultural, thing. But it's not so. It just appears so. It's a very powerful tool. Fiction has the capacity of lowering barriers of the mind to an alternative reality, which can become the truth someday. And in that sense, fiction anticipates reality and perhaps even makes it happen. If there is a problem with fiction, it is the same as its advantage. Its imagination is universal. So it defies individualization, and that's where it's so, it's sometimes fiction does not work. Sometimes it could, but, and that is the reason I had to turn to academic nonfiction, because I wanted to really individualize the stories. And I was writing about farmers and gender, and the lives of people in a way that I could actually write about their daily life more than just like a hit and run research where I could, where I would just study it and come back. So it was part ethnographic and part qualitative. It was interview based, there were narratives. I wanted to record the changes over a period of years, not just months. I wanted to revisit the field and find the difference. I did not want to immerse myself once, I wanted to immerse myself several times. So I sampled the widows of farmer suicides in Vidarbha and followed them for 4 years. Before this, I had done research in Vidarbha, especially because that has Karnataka is the second highest farmer suicides in the country, but Vidarbha has always been number one. So I started my research in Vidarbha in 2004. And this particular book, Widows of Vidarbha, it actually, the research of, for it began in 2014. I used several times these widows or their family members. I was the first person they would see in the morning, and I realized then through that kind of research that how familiarity changes reality again. It is so different from visiting them maybe once or twice in a year or something, and even if I'm living there for a longer period of time, even if going once or twice as compared to going there almost or staying there for months, how different the findings were. I learned the truth that the field tells the research, what the field tells the researcher is dependent on this particular familiarity, especially when it comes to the gender, and that's what I want to talk about from my book. It's a case study. The book has 18 case studies. And again, I'd like to briefly say a few words about the methodology. One of the things which I call the urban lag, I was just having a discussion with another professor, and I was saying there's an urban lag when we access rural areas. We carry a kind of an urban, I don't want to just call it conditioning because it's the mindset, it's everything. I mean, it's so unconscious that it's sometimes difficult to actually be aware of the difference. So what I had done, I wanted these case studies to be in the voice of the women who were speaking and not in my voice or in any way with my consciousness, you know, impinging on theirs. So they were speaking in Marathi. So I translated them back into English. To write, I wrote what I had to write. What I had written as case studies, I translated them back into Marathi and read them out to the women. The findings were very interesting. I realized how, again, that brings me to the same point of the vantage of realities, that I was looking at the reality from a completely different angle, even when I was writing from on their behalf. So they corrected me several times in terms of how I was presenting a particular point, which is why what I'm going to read out now, it looks very stark. And it's not familiarized through our sort of urban way of talking. It's just the way they wanted it. So in a way, this book has been peer reviewed by the widows themselves. The case I'm reading here is about a farmer suicide, and this is the version of his daughter. A very touching version. She did not tell me this in the first two visits, and. As I was saying, that it was a very, 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 very difficult barrier to cross. When I would stop asking all questions, all interviews, all narratives, and there was a point when that silence itself was so comfortable that they started answering on their own. It was very interesting. So I'm going to read this out. Her name is Sneha. She was 20 years old in 2014. And while the rest of the family was burdened by the
or was exercised about the lack of money and the opportunities. In her case, it was something different. Her brown eyes set in a round face smiled in another rendition of the indifference of her family. She had reconciled to the end of her education after class 12. She was still in school, but she was told that the family cannot afford any further education. And she was also told that she would be married. So that was pretty much the end of her education or the any aspiration she had of employment or any other advancement. She was reconciled to this part, but she was still not reconciled to the death of her father, the farmer who had committed suicide. She said, people face troubles all the time. Life is full of problems, but people should stand and fight when they face challenges. My father did not. This is an exact translation from Marathi. As I said, it is absolutely unmediated by my language or my perception. He just left us in the middle of everything. He could have told us he was troubled, that he was contemplating suicide. He did not imagine how his death would affect us, because he would not have left us if he had known what would happen to us without him. She's basically talking about herself. Her dreams were cut short because he died. No one spoke in that room after her words. That was in 2014. As I said, the understanding of the families, what they went through, was stage-wise, was gradual, and I didn't rush it. It was, therefore, it took time. In 2015, 1 year later, she was preparing for her last exam she would ever give in her life, and she was confident of her subjects. But I could also feel it, but I was very glad she started talking about it, because any amount of questioning doesn't really get you those answers. She said, a loan has to be taken every time the crop is sown. There is never any profit. There is never anything to save. And that itself should stop us from indulging in agriculture. But as her own family members reiterated, it was the only thing that farmers were trained to do. It will change, she was very confident. For instance, I will never do agriculture in my life, she said. Someday if I can, I might study. This is what her dream was, to study BA, Bachelor of Education, because I would like to be a teacher. I'm good with history, but not very good with economics. That's what was happening after a particular time, that they could actually smile and joke about their own life, which was rare. The government had paid a compensation. Now, this is the part which I'm reading out, which I don't think I would have accessed if I had not spent so much time with the family. And therefore, this part is very precious to me. The government had paid a compensation of rupees 1 lakh after her father's death. Of the compensation money, some part was handed to the wife, and the rest was put in bank. I'm not getting into the figures here, which are given, but even after 10 years of the death of the father, the government's compensation for the farmer was the only thing that the wife could still count on. She didn't have any other saving. And when it came to Sneha's marriage, it was the same money which was going to be used. In 2015, the search for a suitable groom for Sneha, she was 21, was in full swing. Her relatives were exploring eligible marriage partners for her. She was confident that she would be engaged within that year. There was also a venue selected where the marriage would happen without expenditure. Sneha was aware that the compensation money which was given for the death of her father would be required for the marriage, not just for the ceremony, but also for the dowry. I don't like it, she said, but can I change the system? The dowry must be paid as if it is owed to the groom's side, even if we cannot afford it. And just going against the system was a risk that her mother could not take. Sneha knew that. And her mother saw only one chance of happiness for her child, and she did not want to fritter it away in idealistic experiments. The average dowry, she said, Sneha said, and she had done research on this, she had actually studied, the average dowry to be taken to the given to the bridegroom by the bride's family depends on the quality of the match, whether it is good or bad. A good match was a graduate with a government job or a post in a firm or of repute. A bad match was a farmer. In most cases, the wedding ceremony attendant gifts are borne by the bride's household, and the feast and even the choice of food are stipulated by the groom's family. Usually, even education or good employment made no impact on the bridegroom's desire for dowry. She explains further. For a good match, the dowry is highest at about 5 lakhs. And the bride's family bears all additional costs of a reasonably lavish wedding, which generally works out between 1 to 1.5 lakhs. For an average match, the dowry is 2.5 lakhs with an expenditure of 1 lakh on marriage ceremonies. For a bad match, the dowry expectation is about 50,000 to 1 lakh. Now, this is a calculation a young girl is carrying in her head about the possible marriage and the possible dowry of, and which she knows has to be paid from the compensation money which the state gave after her father died. And that's another thing which I have not come to that point, but there is a constant sadness, that's why, among the women of rural India. It seemed futile to inquire if the groom sought dowry from the poor, whether even educated young men were willing to let the burdens of expense fall entirely on the bride's side. Sneha says, good people do not accept dowry because they can see it is unjust, but some see it as an opportunity to make money. Needless to say, when she got married, she was given, the family had to give a dowry. There is more about Sneha in that book. I don't want to, again, read long passages. I mean, if you have access to the book, that would be nice. So in the end, I just wanted to say that if there was one thing which I understood through various ways of accessing the reality and researching and writing and realizing that it was incomplete and impartial, is that that reality, that truth will always be elusive. And it, to fix it, I mean, to say that one has found it will be to diminish it. I know it will be required to put it under a microscope, study it academically, but we have to also accept that that is not the only way or the only manner in which it can be studied. That's basically what I wanted to say. Thank you.
Hello, ma'am. My question is that in various rural areas where I was doing my field work or wherever I have visited, when we asked, not only in rural but in urban as well, when we asked them ki why their girls or their children are not going to school, most of the time they tell ki because of they don't have that much finances, they don't send their children to school. But then this is the thing when this is a bad thing that they are getting money for their father because of their father's death. But then why they are not using that money in education again, and why they are not investing it? What can be the reason? And second question was, and at the starting you were telling about Sneha's thing ki he should have told us, my father should have told us, we could have helped him. So what is this father's mentality, or I mean to say a man's mentality, yeah, that he is not telling her wife, he is not asking his children, or he is not he is not investing on education or something that they can get rid of this poverty cycle. And what are the things that influence them, and then they are sending their students not to school and not and getting them married?
Thank you, wonderful questions. Thank you very much. To approach the second question first, you know, one of the things which I think goes without getting recorded is the version of the widow about agricultural distress. You know, the feeling of the administration is that what will women know about, you know, agricultural distress? What would they know about tehsildar offices, talatis, land documents, loans? Mahila hai, unko nahi pata hoga, they won't know. You know, that's what a lot of people have told me. You know, what would women know about loans? You know, percentages, interest, and but if the government had asked them, if the government had a procedure where, you know, the version of the widow was actually categorically or in a procedural manner recorded, probably we would have fewer farmer suicides in this country, because to answer your questions, the widow of the farmer farmer is the first witness to his distress. He shares everything with her. Even if he did not, she is a witness to the struggle he's putting to make the family work, the agriculture work. But the problem here is that in a way the state excludes her version. So when it comes to actually what Sneha is saying, the interesting thing is that she is a very outspoken, very rare that she actually started talking, you know, about her situation. Her mother doesn't. Even after so many months, actually 3 years of talking to her, she's not used to articulating her sentiments. She's not used to answering questions. She's not used to being asked questions in the first place. The woman of rural India, especially in the middle of agricultural distress of a certain level of poverty, they do not have any rights of expression. They are invisible. Their only visibility comes when the state engages with them to pay compensation, to get signatures, to get thumb marks. That's when they achieve partial visibility. So again, to coming back to your question, the wife of the farmer, even in this case, the mother of the daughter would have known entirely why the father or the farmer had committed suicide. The thing is, as I said, she is absolutely foreign to the concept of expression. There is an entire half population of this country which doesn't have that right or the freedom to say what they have seen in an organized, in a way that it is taken seriously. So what chance does the daughter have of discovering, you know, why the farmer died? Now that brings to the other question about what you asked about, you know, why do they use the compensation? Why don't they use the compensation? So I was just in Telangana. I was researching there again on this thing. The difference between Vidarbha and Telangana was that the girls are also educated. Not to a very high extent, and not to the same level as the boys. The boys get to graduation, they get sometimes even can achieve, you know, some kind of technical training. But the girls stop ideally, in case of Vidarbha, most of my sample where I had studied about over 50 children in these two districts, they were educated either till 12th or less. And interestingly, even the mothers had the same levels of education. So even in two generations, the levels of education had not changed. Whereas in case of boys, they were getting educated further and further. So any investment when it comes to education, first and foremost goes to the boys. And then if something is left and there is this sense of, okay, ladki ko bhi padhana chahiye, then it goes to the girls. But the girl is always with this told that she is getting educated only until she is getting married. So if a groom or a match is found before, you know, she completes her education or the 12th class or 10th class or whatever, she gets married. Whereas in the case of a boy, he doesn't necessarily stop unless, of course, the family situation is so bad. That now what actually compounds this thing, actually standardizes this conduct, is the state procedure. Now the state, even in this particular case, gave a grant to the boy's education and not to the girls. How did that happen? The state said one child of the farmer's family will be given a grant. Now, who would have got that grant between a boy and a girl? So the boy got the grant. He's, if I'm not mistaken, he's now in his graduation. Since then, he's done pretty well. But my point is that the girl never got a chance. So she carries this anger against the state, which is deliberately making her invisible already. She carries this anger against society, which doesn't make it safe for her to go to the nearest school or the college in her village or the nearby village. And her own family, which constantly wants to get rid of her as a burden. So that's the kind of anger which resides in the hearts of rural girls and women in this country, which is uncharted. That's to answer your question.
Hello, so I had a question that being a journalist, how difficult is it for you to resist the temptation from reporting the actual thing which has happened while turning it into a fiction? Also, is it being unjust to the story? And in the recent times when there have been restrictions and attacks on speaking about what you actually feel, and people have restored themselves to, let's say, writing poems or painting, so just yes. So they don't have to report what is actually happening with them, because the whole thing of resistance is under attack. So how do you see it, and yeah, is it being just to what is happening? I have one more question.
Sure.
So should I say that?
Okay.
Also, you were talking about the increasing space between the reality and what is being reported by the journalist. So the youngsters in the urban spaces have been talking about discussion, like the recent discussion of Me Too movement or Pension Yatra or Kisan Yatra. They have been talking about these issues majorly because it has been there on Facebook or Twitter. So do you see this as an alternative to the mainstream journalism, or is it just an escape from activism? Like, how do you see that being a journalist?
Very good questions. Thank you so much. Now, I think, these are huge movements. They may not look like that, but I think whether you look at Me Too or any of the dissent which is happening in this country at this point is a very, 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 very crucial, powerful revolution. Why? Because I think nothing in this country allows you to speak freely as of today. If we are talking about poverty, there is a very serious chance that you will be called an urban Naxal, right? The moment you talk about those who are not represented, you immediately speak against the government. I don't know how that happens in a democracy. We should always have the right and the freedom to say what is going wrong, and that's exactly what a democracy is about. But I don't think that freedom is entirely there today, not because of any other reason, but because of the threat under which you can be. Now, in that context, what is the only option left with you? To indicate, to actually subvert the method in a way that it tells the truth, at the same time not hurt yourself or your loved ones. That's the only way activism or dissent is possible. And it is not possible for everyone to fight the battle from the, from the front lines. But to make sure that the maximum number of people are actually saying what they have to say, this is the only way. Now, in this context, social media, I think, has done wonders to this right to expression, talking about the Me Too movement. Exactly. I think that has opened up the need for negotiating these issues beyond the mainstream and beyond the government control, which I think is fantastic. So I don't, at any given point, I am all in favor of breaking down methodologies, finding alternative methodologies, because this kind of reality has to be articulated. Yes, you will have to, as I was saying, you have to unlearn a lot to write an investigative piece, an investigation which you have done with a lot of, training and, gathering of documents and facts into a conversation for a fictional book. It really requires a lot of unlearning. It's not easy. But it has to be done, because there is no other way of saying it. It's not just a matter of, personal danger, or it's not just that. There are legal processes. Remember, the law in this country protects everyone, even those who break the law. So we have to, when you have to write about a particular, let's say, corporate house or a malpractice or a tender going wrong, how do you do this? You have this danger that the moment you actually start writing about it, there is a legal action possible. We have seen this recently in the case of a very large defense contract, that people are being muscled with legal action. They are being silenced with that. So what does that mean? Then it means that, you know, we give up and we say that, okay, well, we can't do anything about it because it's the same as personal danger. That's what I meant. So the thing is that you have to subvert your methodologies in a way that you tell the truth. And you should have that kind of control over the methodology that even when you are using something like fiction or journalism or nonfiction or anything, you still are able to be loyal in a way to the reality you are trying to articulate. And that's the only way. And I think social media does wonders to it. And I know a lot of criticism comes in the way that it is unfiltered and that, you know, everything comes into it. But yeah, there is an advantage and there is a disadvantage. And I think I look at the advantage a little more seriously than the disadvantage, that it is a tool in everyone's hands. And you can really protest. You can really raise issues about people, about poor, about women, about segments of our society, which I guess the well-funded corporate media will never raise these issues. We can write about them in social media. So I'm all for it.
Yeah, I just had a question. You know, it's pretty apparent that you're drawing a polarity between journalism and literary and fiction. And one understands that, you know, if you're just reporting facts, then increasingly the climate is such that you are vulnerable and culpable to, you know, repressive action. Which it seems that if you're writing fiction, that is not quite so strident. So in this polarity, where do you see your academic writing?
Well,
I mean, what advantages does it give you and what new challenges would that throw?
Yeah. So my training, as I was saying, was in electoral reform. So, you know, this is the more quantitative, the survey method and all. So as I was saying, that to come from there to write fiction, it takes a little traversing of barriers, which are not easy. But what it did help me do was actually, this is the problem, that once, you know, because of your training, it looks somehow easier, it looks more suitable. But there is still that subtext left unsaid because you cannot totally cover everything in a factual manner. There is perception, there is silence sometimes, which has to be interpreted. Now, for instance, there are so many cases where I've been to visit the family of a farmer who had just committed suicide. And although I know I don't ask questions and I'm just sitting there, there is so much in that silence of that household which has to be written about. Now, how do we write this in academic manner? Now, that is what the challenges have been. And because I cannot write it, I can't exclude it. I mean, that's something which I'm not happy doing. And therefore, I found other ways of doing it. Sometimes it's not even possible doing it in a journalistic manner. As I was telling you about the mythical parliament, so I created a mythical parliament so that I could then, you know, talk about what was happening. And I wanted to raise the questions about how people are not allowed, common people are not allowed into these corridors of power where deals can be made and unmade. And that's something which I could only do in a fiction. That's the advantage of fiction. But in terms of academic writing, of course, as I said, that's probably my first training. So, you know, I mean, it's easier. It looks very possible. It looks like it's headed somewhere and I can suggest interventions which are possible. Like, for instance, in terms of money lending, in terms of loan waivers, whether it has been successful or not, there's no replacement for that. So I think it has to be a concerted effort. And that's where I think that the alternatives are not one instead of the other. They are all together. And my understanding of it, and I don't know if others share this, is that none of them is less or more at all. And it's not like between the qualitative and quantitative what I'm talking about. I'm talking about fiction and nonfiction. And there is this perceptual writing, and there's this factual writing. And I think they both have to come together, really. And not just in books, but also in research articles. I think that would make those research articles far more valuable, especially about rural India, where the things are changing so rapidly and so fast, and the interpretations for instance for urbanization of women, of empowerment, these are constantly changing and sometimes being pushed because of political reasons, electoral reasons, that unless we write about the subtext, the academic writing itself will be quite pointless. Yeah.
I think the question has been asked a couple of times earlier. I might be repeating it.
No, no.
But I'm still trying to see if I can get a coherent answer to this. In academic writing, there's a sense of economy that is always there on your on your mind, right? A sense of proportionality, right? I mean, 10,000 words, 80,000 words, right? And then subsections and all of that. I understand that perhaps poetry is also very similar to that in some sense, right? There's a sense of proportionality. But how do you work, that proportionality out when you are writing, a fictional account?
Mm.
I mean, how do you choose that? For instance, how do you choose the economy of characters who have actually to handle all that you actually want to tell?
I know.
I mean,
That's not an easy thing. Especially, that's the problem with actually fiction, because you are beginning the character. See, academic writing, the person is already there. I mean, even if you are doing a case study, the sample is there. So you don't have to really make the person happen. In fiction, you're making the person happen. You're so right about it. It's like a challenge, like nothing else. And I have I grappled with this for the last 15 years. And I think even now I mean, the character has to evolve himself or herself along the way of the book. I can never arrive at a character and say that, okay, this person is going to do this and is going to represent this. What I can do, and which I consciously do, is I make sure that the fiction books are based in real research. So when I'm talking about farmer suicide, every single character in my fiction is also a real character. So they are case studies from that sense. But you still need one absolutely imaginary character. And this is what was very, very interesting to find. So although almost 90%, if I had 10 characters in a book, 9 of them would be real life, like a doctor from a zonal hospital, an old lady who has perhaps cancer and nobody can afford her treatment, or a young boy who has to work in someone's house so that he can go to school. They're all real characters. But to put them all together in the kind of a story that I want to tell, because they are very different unitary characters in real life, to put them all together, I still need one character which I have to create. And that has been the challenge. So now, what does that character, first the gender, then what kind of person it should be? Oh God, that really was a lot of learning. So that economy which you're talking about, oh my God, that's the center of the challenge of everything. But having done that a few times, it's addictive. And it is something which is what I'm saying, that sometimes you feel that you wish there was a character like this in real life, actually, who put all these people together and actually pushed them towards some kind of a solution. You know the solution is fictitious because, you know, you have written it in fiction. But as I'm saying, that the mind has a way of actually anticipating it on ground. So although you have written it in fiction, you are looking for the character on the field in an academic manner. And therefore, you are covering both ends of the spectrum in your own imagination, you know. And then you do find sometimes, you know, not in probably one person, that imaginary character you thought who should be, let's say, maybe who should have one character, maybe he should be rebellious or something, or honest. You may not find it in one person, but when you put together maybe 5 people, then you think, yes, this character I had created, you know. So yeah, it's been fascinating, actually. Yeah, but that's the thing, that I had to really, I didn't get into fiction to just write popular fiction, and you know, I wanted to write about the stories of these people. For instance, in an earlier book, Shoes of the Dead, which is getting made into a movie beyond, you know, my belief, but I talk about a doctor who really struggles, you know, to treat patients. He's a real life character. I mean, he does. I know this doctor who is from that local area. He works in a zonal hospital, and but in that book he had to have that extra something, you know, which comes from some other character. So, but that guy had to be written about, you know. There was nothing academic I could do about him, you know. He had this very sensitive heart. He was from a very poor family. He became a doctor to serve in the villages. He was serving in the villages. He was doing exactly what he wanted to do in life, and he looked absolutely miserable. But that was the point of it, you know. He wanted that misery. He wanted to be there. And how do you write this in an academic research? It's at the level of the heart, probably at the mind, that it defies actually, you know, a narrative thing. He would never say this. I mean, you only watch him and you realize this is what it is. So, in terms of rural distress, but electoral writings, yes. I remember Mukulika Banerjee's book on Why India Votes. Very interesting book on, but that's slightly ethnographic, and I have, you know, ethnographic work is that way very powerful in that sense. So she follows voters of several villages on the voting day and what they go through day before and after. I think it's fantastic. I mean, of course, M.N. Srinivas, all this very, that kind of research which is on the ground. But what I still believe is that a single methodology still leaves something out, you know. An ethnographic kind of research of that kind of field, I think, would leave scope for someone with a more quantitative bent of mind to say that, okay, you can't generalize what you're finding, what's the point of finding this? So, you know, there is that debate going on. So that's why I say that, you know, we really need to be subversive with our methodologies.
Okay.
I'm
very much moved with the information that you have shared, and
thanks
very much for that.
Thank you.
So having said that, when you write something, the untold story, in the form of a journalistic article or an academic paper, it will inform people to come up with some kind of intervention or action. So I'm just interested to know, like, you have collected so much of data from the people who have come up with that suffering and all. So with the information that you have collected, by any chance, did it actually inform someone to come up with an intervention or take some kind of action to actually help them?
So I think, fantastic question. I mean, this is the kind of question which I think everybody who has been on the field asks, okay, you're doing all this, will it really change the field eventually? You know, will anything change? But I must say that I've stopped asking myself that question in this country, because it is so difficult to write or talk about the poor in this country. Firstly, they don't make the headlines of our corporate-owned media houses and television channels. Secondly, the women among rural poor, even more relegated than the farmers. So I don't expect at all the intervention to come from the state or the, you know, the regular suspects, as we call the policy makers, or this is not happening. I think the only change personally comes from the society, and that's not because we are communicating these problems outside the social circles, but because there is an awareness that has happened in let's say the societies of Vidarbha or Telangana, where I'm researching, and they bring about the change within their own this thing. So I would, to take Fukuyama's argument, I think that it's the society which is eventually going to influence how the policy and politics happen in this country, and not the other way around. But having said that question is very, very, very important, that will there be any change from what we write? I think it was George Orwell who said, didn't he, that, you know, we write to change the world, because without that, why would you write? I mean, that's the fundamental reason. Having also said that, I think every intervention is several steps in which the government also plays a role, the policy plays a role, everybody plays a role. So it's not necessary that I get to know what influence I have on somebody who's reading, you know, which eventually leads to an intervention which can actually do some good. But because I have a very narrow or a sharp focus on a particular section, so I would be very happy if somebody just who was looking at that, like gender, rural poverty, farmer suicides, would think of an intervention based on that. At the end of every fiction, even the fiction books which I write, unlike fiction books, I have a conclusion, I have a list of recommendations on what can be done to address the situation.
So I'll just also tell you like why I asked that question.
Yes.
So recently during the Kerala floods, I read a story where a girl actually donated her kitty bank money to Kerala. She saved that money to buy a cycle. And there is a person who saw that and has actually got a cycle. So it might be a small story, but so while you were actually sharing that story, I just actually felt that, okay, if I would have known about that, like I would have somehow bought someone to fund that girl to pursue her studies. Yeah. So in that sense, I'm just trying to interest that you have known a lot of stories where those people could be helped in some or other way through some NGO intervention or some outsiders who are really willing to provide support. So in that way, I actually asked that question. So
very nice, very nice. Well, I hope somebody does actually. That would be wonderful if they did.
Neelima, I had a question on
how
you know that you might actually be using different notions of reality even within this talk, because the reality of corruption in the parliament language is completely adequate to capture that.
Mm.
To see what's going wrong, how things are being rigged.
Yeah.
But the reality of someone's death,
yeah,
like you said, the silence which is impossible to grasp through language. So that's a very different notion of reality.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'm not quite clear about what this genre mixing or method mixing is trying to achieve. I think there are different orders of, the different orders of objectives altogether, I feel. If you, psychoanalysts will tell you straight away, reality is unbearable. There's too much violence, and language is precisely something that lets you not see the violence.
Absolutely.
The symbolic world allows you to live
thinking
you're living peacefully, and there's enormous violence.
Yeah, yeah.
So I just wanted because, you know, when Gulliver Travels is written, that's a critique of the British Parliament, Tories, and that takes the form of satire. Not
right.
committed to reality at
right,
all.
Right, right, yeah.
So I'm just, you know, the Bible is very real,
right.
can even get things to happen even now,
right.
but it's
right.
about a world that doesn't exist anymore. You know, I'm just trying to get you to think,
share
with us how you have tried to see, this. If you're working with a plural conception of the of reality, that's all.
Right,
And what kinds of demands it might make on you as a practitioner of or a descriptor.
Yeah, I don't know about others, but I have always. My writing has been driven by disappointment. That's basically it. Probably that's why it looks like, and that's the common thread through the entire thing. I think disappointment is a very very general and a very simple word, oversimplified way of putting it, but. It's always that, you know, once I'm done with a text, I've always found that there's so much which has been left unsaid and there's nothing I could do to say it in that particular text. The only option I was left with was to leave it unsaid. So that was the reason why I left journalism in the first place, that this wasn't happening. And the more starkly I was, as you correctly said, the violence of the language, that the more starkly I tried to say it, the less honest or the less sincere it was. So I think that's what drives my work, my research for methodologies. The only advantage I see in doing this is that when I'm talking about farmer suicides or women or the widows of farmers, I'm hoping that through the fiction which actually builds that side of the story where I was absent. And the non-fiction where I was present. So there are two sides to the story which I'm able to cover. And I think that is what is driving my methodology. Now, the reason why I mix these is fundamentally because of this. Having said that, you're absolutely right on this, that there's this entirely anarchic kind of layering which happens when one mixes methodology. But there's nothing I can do about it, because I cannot possibly live with the disappointment that I didn't tell this side of the story. And especially when I can. If I can, I would love to do that. I mean, even if I'm boring the fiction readers, ki ye kya likh diya isne, why is she not writing about, you know, celebrities and nightlife, doesn't matter. But let's try to tell the story from inside these homes rather than from outside, like an academician would or a researcher would, where I'm visiting and then getting the story from there. And in case of fiction, I can be inside the house. And that's the travel, you know, which I'm trying to cover, as I was saying, a point where I'm present and a point where I'm absent. So that's the journey. So thanks for the question, Bernard. Thank you so much. Oh.
I don't think that media houses have this tradition of giving their ideological leanings out in open.
Great question.
What's your take on that? I mean, how it shapes the way the news is covered by different media organizations? And because as a reader, I feel myself on certain stories completely puzzled. Ki is pe bharosa kar rahi hai. Because now, after coming of Swaraj magazine, and then you have on other side portals like Scroll, Wire, or News Laundry, they take different side of story.
Absolutely.
And these
absolutely.
Take, so what's your take on
brilliant,
that?
Should brilliant they, question. Absolutely.
Reveal their ideological leanings in the beginning itself, or what?
No. Absolutely brilliant question. I think there should be a compulsory disclosure of ideology in this country. I mean, we should have a running scroll under Republic TV or something. Who do they actually belong? That's true. That's true. Or party they support or something, because this is so right. You know, to give another example, there were several journalists who had joined political parties in 2014 election and before that, 2013-12. Now, before they joined the political parties, they were covering news from a tilted point of view. So we didn't know this. We, as viewers, realized why they were covering news in that selective manner only later when they left journalism and went and joined a political party. Now, that is absolutely unethical. You can't do this. Similarly, there are journalists who are aiming at positions of power in the present dispensation or earlier governments. When they are looking at positions of power and or let's say parliament nominations or whatever you want to call them, how can they still work as journalists? Because then they are actually trying to, you know, build their CV through covering news and telling news to the people. That shouldn't be allowed. So absolutely brilliant question, it has to be. But the real question is, why doesn't anybody raise this doubt or follow up on this? We have media bodies in this country. We have serious activists who work on this. We have former and present editors who claim to be very liberal, very, you know, upright. So why don't they ask this question and actually make this happen? And that raises a very serious question about liberal journalism in this country, actually. But thanks, wonderful question. Thank you. Thanks.